Okay, so I'll just do a little bit of introduction of what we do at Soham. See, Soham Inner Development is something which we have started last year. Me and Anil, actually Anil Pammi has also joined us today. I mean, he's always there. He's one of the key people who ensures the technical aspect goes well. So welcome, Anil. Soham Inner Development is a platform we started with the whole idea of personal development with a societal goal in mind. We want a healthier society and healthier individuals. And we include spiritual component in our workshops. So we have three streams. One is a holistic wellness stream. For those who don't know me, I am a psychiatrist by profession. I'm Dr. Srinivas Sastri Malladi. And Anil is from an engineering background, and he has conducted leadership workshops as well. So we have three streams, and one we do is a holistic wellness stream, and of which one, those in bold, we have been conducting the Dive Inward series, Discover Yourself and Discover Your Inner Potential, and Bringing Out the Best in You, Sanatana Dharma Way. We have the Indic knowledge stream as well, of which we have been conducting once in bold, Eternal Bond of Science and Sanatana Dharma, Understanding and Practicing Sanatana Dharma, Let's Go to the Basics. And recently, Seshagiri Mahodaya has conducted Exploring Vishishta Advaita. And the third stream is perhaps more relevant to my field of work, and it's a mental health stream, of which more recently we started conducting understanding mental illness through or mental health through stories. Okay, so these are some of the things what that we conduct, and that is about us. But now about today's topic. The reason I wanted Ravi to come over and talk about this idea of or share with us the essence of Sanatana Dharma from the first ever Sanskrit animation movie Punyakoti. See, Punyakoti, those who have watched it would agree with me that it has actually broken a few kind of barriers in ensuring that we start hoping for Samskritam to become mainstream, and also present the essence of Sanatana Dharma in an unapologetic way, the way it should be done. This is at least from my observation of the movie. Of course, I'm associated in a small way with the movie, and perhaps I may be biased, but this is the feedback I have been getting from lots of people as well. Ravi himself is an ardent practitioner of Sanatana Dharma, and I have seen him, spoken to him, and he's a true gentleman and very humble. So we will hear about his approach to life through Sanatana Dharma, and through, of course, talking about the film through the presentation. The Punyakoti itself has received a lot of accolades, and you can see there. And we have a young Tejaswi Surya as well, appreciating the quality of animation and the music. And music was done by none less than Maestro Ilayaraja, Isai Gnani, as we call him. And he has been my music guru as well, especially when I have been growing up in my younger days. So a little bit about Ravi. Ravi Shankar Venkateswaran is a marketing and HR consultant living in Bangalore. He has exposure to advertising, publishing, multimedia, and animation for the last 20 years, 20 plus years. He worked for more than a decade for the IT major Infosys in their outsourcing division. He also holds a defensive patent for digitally verifying documents. Ravi had a lifelong dream of making an animation movie. He made the story of Punyakoti a cow that speaks the truth, the subject of his dream project. A Sanskrit workshop in Infosys inspired him to make the movie in the divine language. If I am right, I think this must be the Dashadena Shiviram of Samskrit Bharati. And yeah, and he's currently working on the script for making an animated movie on Swami Vivekananda. His hobbies include yoga, Vedanta, music, and alternative medicine. So I know time is precious. So what I will do is I'll stop sharing my screen and I'll also mute myself. So Ravi, it's all over to you now.
So anyway, before I go into Punyakoti and Sanatana Dharma, I wanted to actually open the session with one song that comes in the movie, and people who have seen the movie know that like this song is the core of the movie itself. So we all have heard of Satsang. Now let's listen to some Satsang.
सत्यं जनको जननी सत्यं सत्यं स्वजनो दैवं सत्यं सत्यं भाषा सत्यं कृत्यं तुल्ये भाषा कृत्ये नित्यं सत्यं धैर्यं निर्भय दीक्षा सत्यं जनको जननी सत्यं satyam swajano devam satyam.
I will so my presentation today is divided into three or four parts. I will try and do justice to the request that Srinivasa Mahodaya has made to actually present my association with both Punyakoti and with Sanatana Dharma. Okay. I want to thank him for the opportunity first, and I am actually humbled. I don't think I deserve to speak to such an august audience. You know, like I probably am the least, but in spite of that, I accepted this because I think I didn't have any profound things to say except my own experiences. So I hope you would kind of bear with me if there are things that are not like so profound or anything like that, but they are just my experiences. With that, I will just start. So let me start with saying how Punyakoti and Sanatana Dharma are connected in that sense, because Sanatana means the eternal and the permanent, and in a way it's opposite to everything that is temporary or unreal and something that doesn't change. So if you were to apply the same qualities, I realized that Satyam also has that quality, that it doesn't change and it is beyond time and space, and it doesn't change. It remains eternal. Whereas we all are like temporary fixations or a slice of time in this whole universe. And I realized that is why Satyam eternally appeals to all of us. And I did not realize it at that depth or anything like that when I started writing, when I heard the Punyakoti story and I wanted to make a movie about it. But slowly and slowly, this I realized when I was going through the entire process of movie making. Give you a little bit about my own inspiration for how this story appealed to me and why it was very special to me and what it did to me. So even though I was born in Bangalore, I did a part of my schooling in Bangalore, I had never heard of the Punyakoti story before. And my first time I was hearing the story was sometime in 2013. And somehow I had a bus mate. My house is about 1 hour away from Infosys. So every day we used to go by bus, office bus was there. And my colleague and I used to have a lot of conversation on different types of things. He was also spiritually bent. But it was not serious conversation. It was like a very fun conversation. And he told me, have you heard this story? I said, no, I have not heard this story. And then when he told me the story, I had tears in my eyes. And I realized that there were so many things, and that's the beauty of Satyam. I said, like, see, you can connect this story to so many things that are happening today in the world. And he asked me how. I said, like, look, there must be a story behind the cow. There must be a story behind the tiger. There must be a story for the village in which it happened. We are only hearing that there was a cow, it had an encounter with a tiger. Maybe there is a bigger story lying in the village, bigger story that was leading to this meeting. So he told me, oh, Ravi Shankar, that's a very nice way of thinking about it. So I told him, this is not very difficult. I can write a story on this. But it took me many, many months after that, because I always thought, okay, it came as a story and I forgot about it. And after a point of time, one day, that's how I'm saying, why I'm saying this particular piece is to say that maybe it was destined to happen. That is why. Because I never intended to make this a movie or even complete that story. So this was just a story that I had made up of the village, of the bridge, of nature getting distracted. All these things were a story that I had made up. And in my mind, this was just like a story I wanted to tell my daughter and things like that. Then one day, a person I had met long back, in 2007, I had met him. And he called and said, you inspired me to do something. You know, like, because of you today, I have made a movie and all those things. Then I realized I had spoken to another person in 2007 about making a movie and all. And I had myself attempted to make a movie long back in 2007 and I had not succeeded. Then I decided, why take all this trouble? Movie making is not easy. Maybe working in Infosys is easier, okay? Because you get monthly salary, no risk. So my life is just this. I don't want to do anything further than this. And I had just left it at that. But this phone call changed all that. I said, a person I have spoken to, he's been able to make a movie. Whereas I cannot make a movie. This is not. So I said, today itself, I'm going to write a story. So I sat down and finished the entire story in one go. And it just flowed. Okay. Until then, it was just in my, mind or heart, or I don't know which part of the consciousness it was staying. But it just started flowing and flowing and flowing and flowing. And I just finished writing it. And it took another few months for this. So I had self-published the book. So like this, slowly, 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 it is like they say, no, that the Dharayati Dharmahad. So the somehow the thread was all connecting. So I was not aware that all this is happening for a purpose. Okay. Whereas I was living in my story. I was thinking that this is not possible, this is difficult, and all those stuff. And then the Sanskrit workshop happened, and then of course the crowdfunding and the idea, then I put up a website, then I got some concept artwork done, then I went to Bombay, and one small article came in midday saying that there is a person who is planning for a crowdfunded crowdsourced movie on Punyakoti, and Srinivas Mahodaya saw that clip. I don't know how he even got an opportunity to see that clip, okay? Because I think it was just like one column, very small piece in one newspaper. And he called me and he seed funded this project. And that is how this project started. He and a few others, my mentors and everybody. And we started this project. We didn't know where the rest of the money was going to come from, who was going to give the voiceover, how am I going to do all this? But like we started, we said, let the journey start, you know. So this whole Sanskrit movie making process, if you actually see, I am the least qualified person because my Sanskrit knowledge was maybe LKG level. It's still at LKG to UKG level. I can understand Sanskrit. I can speak a little bit, but I'm not advanced level student of Sanskritam or anything like that. Okay. So that is why I keep thinking that I am just a Nimittam, or this is what I told Srinivas Mahodaya when I met him. I said, maybe I'm just somebody has chosen, or nature has chosen me to execute this project, because I have never made a movie before. I have never written a film script before. I don't know any big names in the film industry. I was outside the film industry. Okay. And somehow, slowly, people started getting associated with the project. I started meeting people. Out of 100 people I meet, sometimes only one or two people will get convinced that they should help me. But this meant that I had to just go along with it. So what this whole experience for me was, it was an opportunity to practice Sanatana Dharma. We all keep saying that it is not because of us it is happening, it is all destined and things like that. It is all karma, that, this and all. But Punyakoti gave me a real opportunity to practice that in on the ground, because I had to keep reminding myself, and Srinivas Mahadeva knows this very much. I'm not a very courageous person, okay? I'm not this person, whatever challenges come, let us take it on. I'm not that kind of a person. I get frightened very easily. Oh, will this happen? Will that happen? What if it doesn't happen? What if people shout at me? I have taken their money. All that chanchalam will be there in my manas, okay? But I will still say myself, okay, I am just a messenger. If it has to happen, it will happen. I will do my duty, okay? If the money comes, I will do a good job. Okay, if the funds come, if the people come, I will not make any compromise in my duty. So it gave me an excellent opportunity to actually tell myself and practice day after day after day after day that I have only karmanyaga adhikaraste. So all other things I don't have any control over. So how to know that all this can happen? Only if you practice, you will know, right? And the other thing I kept telling is, I should be flexible. I should this one. Let me do my work as best as I can. If God gives you a lemon, make a lemonade out of it. So I just practiced and practiced and practiced. Okay. By no means it was easy. And then I realized that at the end of the day, Sanatana Dharma can only be practiced. Okay. It is just like yoga. It is just like a lot of other things. And you will make mistakes. So I saw a few people who are doctors. Doctors, they never call them experts. They just call themselves practitioners, because they know that every case is a new case, right? So they have to approach it without bias, without this one. They have to be clear. They have to first clean the slate and look at it from a fresh eye. So Sanatana Dharma to me was also like that. It was like every time I did, I realized how much weakness I have, how much prarabdha I am carrying, how much of my vasanas come from other things, how much I have to clean myself. And I would honestly claim that, like, I am just on the journey. I am not an expert. Okay. So this was like part one of my story, okay, of making the Punyakoti movie. So how did I bring in Sanatana Dharma into the script itself? Okay. So the script itself was a reflection of two very critical things that I wanted to kind of share, which was Satya and Dharma. Okay. So Punyakoti being the representative of Satya itself, and how nature works, you know, how the whole universe comes together, and how it was like it should work, right? Like the world works because there is workability. It's giving simple examples, like I tell somebody that I will come at 6 o'clock, I come at 6 o'clock, it works for both of us. You know, it doesn't cause a lot of friction and things work out. If I tell that I will do a piece of work and I do a piece of work, it works. So to me, Dharma was not about morality, right, wrong, or any of those kind of things. Okay. And also that, like, actually what makes it work is that Satya. And I wanted to bring this into the script itself. So I naturally, if somebody wants to make a movie, they will look at a lot of Western scripts and things like that. But the first place that I went to is actually Natya Shastra, Bharata's Natya Shastra. Of course, I was not an expert to interpret all of it. So I went to Anupama Hosakare, who was a puppeteer, who does puppet shows in Bangalore. And she had a lot of insights in this area. you know, like how to make puppets, how to move puppets, and how to stage it. And I saw that like how stage was getting ready for all those things. So I wanted to actually show that how as a society and how there was this underlying soul in the whole thing. And this was not like a very linear way of telling a story, that there was one hero, there was one villain, they came and finally the villain got defeated, the hero won. I didn't want to kind of bring any of those things. So you will see that in many, many, many aspects of my storytelling in the movie itself. For one example I wanted to give was giving back life, right? Like the like all life is connected by Panchabhuta. And if you actually see when we introduce Punya Koti, she comes and actually helps a bird get revived. And if you see with her, she just licks the bird. And whatever the Panchabhuta principles which had gone out of alignment in the body comes back into alignment. So this is a very subtle message. So nobody will get it. But if you see every aspect of all the Bhutas, no, the colors, the shapes, everything we researched and put it. So even though it comes for 2 seconds, we have done enough work to show that these things were already present in nature and they are all coming together. And the second aspect that I kind of brought into the script itself was to say that it was okay to make mistakes, and mistakes made out of ignorance, right? So this is an aspect of Sanatana Dharma where I say that the Jivatma will continue and take its journey. In its journey towards becoming a Mahatma or a Paramatma, it will make mistakes. So it is very human. So that kind of an acceptance and that wisdom has to come to say that, okay, it is okay to make mistakes. Because otherwise, I found that in a lot of storytelling style, it is only about right, wrong, black and white. Here I wanted the child to make a mistake. And I wanted Ajji, the old person, the wise person, to come, and that's the next point that I want to give. Like our gods are not perfect. They actually come, take on a human being's form. And that's why she tells the story of Lord Krishna to the child. She says that, don't you know that as a child, he used to actually steal Navanitam. So it is okay. Later on, he became a big statesman. He became a big ruler. He became a great advisor. He became a loved by everybody. So it is very, very, so I also wanted to tell that it is not easy. It is a difficult journey in life. But like you should be okay to forgive yourself and move on. And I am sure that people who work or practitioners of Sanatana Dharma also have a very big heart. They are able to forgive, they are able to overcome. And that is also one of the reasons is an eternal flow, and it doesn't get stopped by did not happen, that did not. So it is not breaking up. It's a very flexible, open architecture kind of a thing. It self adjusts itself, and that cannot happen if you are moral, because moral actually is a fixed rigid stand, and then it breaks up. And then I wanted to bring in another aspect of Sanatana Dharma into the script, which is to say that that is seen, that is very visible. Okay, here I will give an example, like talking about evidence-based medicine. And that is like throwing the baby with the bath water. You know, I mean, we say that all aspects of mind does not matter. That only what is seen matters, what is manifested matters. You know, so I wanted to bring in this aspect because this I have seen that like the mind, spirit, all these things play a very big role in our life. They probably our emotions. And I was also surprised that like people gave a Nobel Prize to a couple of very experienced economists to say that people invest money emotionally and they don't invest money rationally. But why should they give a Nobel Prize? It is very evident, no? Like anything that they are attached to, anything that they deal with, people will deal emotionally only. I mean, relationships are emotions. Emotion-based, this one. So wisdom and other things are very rare things. That's why Ajji comes and says, so I had to bring in that entire thing into the script. So when I wrote the script, I told that okay, why are people are looking at the drought and saying, oh, drought happened because this happened, because that happened, because that happened. If beyond a point, you will not be able to see the thousands. But if you clean yourself, or if you tune yourself, you will be able to experience and see multi-dimensional connections. And that's why for me that character was very, very important. And she had to come and she had to tell the people that, look, and we always ignore wisdom first. And that is also something that I brought into the movie. You know, like, there are people who will come and say wise things, but then, like, in our, because inexperience, sorry, because of our ignorance, or people, even because of our lack of experience, we ignore these things. And we say, oh, it doesn't matter. And it takes us a while to kind of get it back. You know, I mean, that is also, you will see, if you actually see the sukshma script, you know, sukshma sharira, there is a sukshma script that is underlying. There is a subtle aspect of it that will come in. And the aspect that I brought in was that it is not a hero versus villain story at all. Whereas Indian storytelling, if you see, if you take any legendary things, after Ravana was killed, Rama actually performs his last rites. He asks forgiveness. And before Ravana passes away, he goes and asks for advice from Ravana. He says, you are an experienced administrator. Why don't you teach me some aspect of running an empire? Okay. So, see, this is very, very different from a Western way of storytelling. Everybody gets redeemed. Okay. Everybody gets back to their original self. Yes, of course, they make mistakes and things like that. That is why you will see that in all our stories, whether it is Krishna's story, Rama's story, or even their storytellers, if you take, you know, like everybody from a Valmiki, everybody, they have all restored themselves. Okay. And this is the point. And if you actually see this towards the end of the movie, I have actually said, everybody will end the movie. I did not end this movie. Okay, so of course, the Western all do this trick of storytelling to say there is a sequel coming. Okay. In my case, it was not a trick to say that there is a sequel that is on the anvil, but to say that we have a cyclical view of life. So I keep telling people, we were able to invent the zero much before the Westerners, because we always think in cycles. So round, 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 we were thinking, and that is how we were able to look at it. We don't think that one is the starting, you know, we think zero is the starting. And this is very, we have a cyclical way of thinking. And if you actually see, if you look at the Western medicine also, the other ether they had found out, but Ayurveda is the only system of medicine that has Akasha, or empty space, as the beginning, as one of the Bhutams in the Panchabhuta. Whereas the Greek system, the Unani system, all recognize the visible ones. Okay. Whereas, because we always think that something starts, manifests, and then ends, and then the cycle continues. So in my movie also, many years pass by, but still drought is coming, still Punyakoti's daughter has been called to break the pot, and the cycle continues. Okay. And the last point that I had built into the movie was Dharmo Rakshati Rakshitaha, which is to say, look, we have to protect nature. Okay, it is in our interest. Okay, so the West thinks that, we are saving nature and all. No. Nature, you will see that, like, we as in the human race, you know, including, I'm not saying that the West is different or East is different. We are also victims of the same psyche, right? It took less than 1 gram of virus to bring all of us to our knees, right? To bring Dharma back to its, this one. If you see, pollution came down, animals started walking on the roads, and all this happened because it was a way for Mother Nature to tell us, look, you can't even deal with half a gram of virus. What you are thinking that you are running this world? Nothing. You know, if I want, it will take me half a second to bring everything back to normal. Okay, so this is one big realization that many people don't have. we don't have to save nature. Nature knows very well how to save itself. We have to save ourselves. And that is why our way of looking at dharma as a complementary system. You know, nature is not for us to exploit. Okay, we cannot exploit nature. If nature decides, it will clean itself in one day. And we have all seen that in reality, you know, I mean, this timing could not have been better. So a lot of this is part of the script itself in the Punyakoti movie. And it's my belief, I don't know whether it will happen. The project has a life of its own. Punyakoti has a life of its own. And to me, the people who have joined this call today are all, in a way, the propagators of that dharma. Because I will share with you, we have to take this forward. Okay, as a movie maker, 5 years of the prime of my life, I was able to dedicate and bring something. But I will not be there to sit in front. Like when I was doing the music, Ilaraja sir was telling me that there was one portion that was lagging. So he was composing the music for that, and he told me, why, Ravi Shankar, this is stretching a little bit. So I told him, sir, this is a very important part of the movie, sir. Then he said, will you sit next to your audience and tell them this is a very important part of the movie, you please see it. Okay. I said, no. So the movie should do the work, Ravi. You should not do the work. Okay, so next time you be careful. So this was a very, very powerful lesson for me. So I wanted the movie to convey all these things. And it has a very sattvic, very balanced way of storytelling. Children should watch it. It should not like trigger a lot of rajasic aspects in the psyche. You know, I mean, there should be a balance. There should be visuals, there should be colors, there should be drama. And there should also be that you should feel calm when you watch the movie. Okay. And then when you walk out of the movie, you should feel fulfilled. I don't know how much of this got done, because as the audience should validate all this, but at least I just wanted to share the intentions that I had and how in several parts of the movie, I had actually woven a lot of Sanatana Dharmic principles into the movie. These are my lessons from making this movie. I am not advising anybody about Sanatana Dharma, because I know that many of you are much bigger practitioners than me. Okay, for me personally, as a new generation person or this generation person, somebody who works with young people, information, architecture, process, technology, and all those things, I am just sharing how Sanatana Dharma is very close to me. Okay, what aspects of it is very close to me? For me, it is not dogmatic. It doesn't say do this, otherwise this will happen. Do that, it will not happen. It says you can go and experiment with it. No, I will give you the sandbox. I will give it. I will keep it open. So I love the flexibility and the freedom that it offers to me. And I keep telling my children also that you can start anywhere in the continuum. You know, you can start from being a non-believer and go on to be a believer. And of course, we don't use the word belief or faith or any of those kind of Abrahamic nomenclature in the Sanatana Dharma. We just say that you start your exploration, because it is your personal journey. You can customize this entire religion to yourself. And the second thing I realized is I suddenly used to feel guilty. Oh my God, I mean, a good part of my life I have wasted, you know. I discovered Sanskritam after I was 40 years. Okay. And I used to say, oh my God, I have wasted so much life, so much this one. So I feel very, very reassured that this is the time in my journey that I had to discover it. You know, so it was not like, so I don't have to wallow in guilt. I can have this peace of mind to say, maybe I will discover more. I will be open to more and more of it. And also, the other aspect of Sanatana Dharma that answers a lot of questions for me personally is karma itself, the theory of karma. Because it says that I am responsible for a lot of things, and whatever is happening to you is because of my karma, then it puts me in charge of my life, and therefore I can undo a lot of things. I can clean up a lot of things. I can complete a lot of things. I can move on. And the last aspect of it is inclusivity, because it includes everything that you can see. You know, from na astikam to astikam, anything inside the continuum, idol worship, non-idol worship, thinking of the Brahman, not thinking of the Brahman, having your own, like the Indian wedding, no? Indian wedding is never consistent. It is not even coded. But it is, everybody will have a local this one. And depending on which flower is available locally, which fruit is available locally, which food is available locally, which herbs are available locally, which clothing is available locally. So it can be localized and it can be made inclusive. Anything that is available in your environment, you can include it into your way of worshipping, include in your own personal, this one. And the last piece that I want to say is that between Rajas and Tamas, you know, like people who become very active, become activists or reactivists. You say something, they will react. So they are react between, and to the others who are in complete tamas, you know, they don't take any action at all. They say, yeah, what to do? It is like that. I had to actually find somewhere in the middle, you know, some kind of a sattva, because I realized it is about workability. And just like how the Trigunyam is also about workability in the body, following our dharma also is about workability. We have to, because it's, you cannot get a more flexible religion. You cannot get a more flexible outlook to things. And you have to find the sattva in it. You have to actually have a balance between overactivism. You have to have a balance between overthinking, which leads you to tamas, overactivity, which leads you to rajas. You have to find a middle ground where action is possible. You know, if you keep thinking, it will not happen. If you keep doing without thinking, that will also not happen. So you have to find what works, and you have to follow a middle path, and you have to assert yourself. You have to, but assert yourself in a very balanced way. And that is also one lesson, one practice I could actually, I had an opportunity to practice all of this, to work with different kinds of people, to work with different ideologies, people with different preferences, people whose what's in it me was completely different from what's in it me for me. All the people who worked in this movie did not work because they wanted to actually uphold Samskritam or anything. You know, like I went like that with the ideology. But many people said, sir, I am not able to pay my son's fee. I am not able to pay my next month's house rent. No, I am interested in getting a job, in getting a salary, in getting a fees. So I realized that, okay, ideology alone will not be enough. You have to actually find some workability also inside all of these things. So that's been one of my biggest lessons as far as Sanatana Dharma goes, and how it is my experience of Sanatana Dharma. We'll move to the last part of this one today, and saying how I brought in all these things. You know, like once I say I'm a follower or a practitioner of Sanatana Dharma, I realized that I had to actually bring in a lot of things into my life. And the things that I brought into my life was to actually start to observe even basic things like nature. I used to earlier not know the difference between Amavasya and Purnami. I mean, I was that ignorant. You know, every day was the same day. So today, at least now I know that there is a moon, it waxes, it wanes. There is a Ritu Bhedam that happens in our surrounding. Our day changes. Simple things. You know, so how connected our dharma was to nature. So that was a big, big awakening for me. And I started seeing the connections between all the languages that we have, all the words that we use in our this world, and simple things like, if I don't know the Sanskritam word, at least I will go and check the Hindi equivalent of it. And I'm trying to avoid a lot of using non-Indian words in my daily conversation. If I am stuck for a word, I will go and check. Give me a second. There is a call. I'll just cut it. All right. So subsequently, and I also took to at least doing basic things like now I do japa, I do dhyana, I do yoga, my pranayama, everything. I moved back to sattvic cooking. Now I am aware of all the herbs, what they do. So I actually integrated. So it's not about just becoming a practitioner of Sanatana Dharma. It is bringing in a lot of, I realized that just talking about nature is not enough. Bringing that awareness. You don't have to separately have an ecological movement, eco-friendly movement. You don't have to become a green person. You don't have to do anything. Okay. You just have to follow Sanatana Dharma and you will do the right things naturally. You will start respecting nature. You know, all the people who say that I am a green warrior and all those things, they are green activists. They just have to get into Sanatana Dharma and they will see that how everything is a sadhana in their life. And this realization is such a wonderful realization for me. And I feel lucky that at least in this lifetime, in this one, in this age, that by I don't know whose grace that I got this awareness. This is just the last part of my presentation. And what I have got further is actually maybe we can just a little bit about the movie itself. I will spend the next 5 minutes or so just to show you some samples to say it is also a way of showing off that I have done a lot of work for the movie before the final thing. So I have some few things to share which are visually rich also. What you can see here are all the character designs that we did for the movie. The entire gamut of characters. Each of these characters did not look like what they are looking today when the movie started. We went through a lot of iterations. So most of the characters are actually second or third time iterations of the same characters. So I have included one character which is not in the movie also, which is slightly violet in color in the first row. Just to tell you that how many characters, more than 100 characters were developed, discarded, and finally we arrived upon this set. I will go to the next slide. After we did the movie, we had to draw almost every pose. And this is just not the final drawings, okay? It is just rough drawings to say how each screen, each shot will look like. And as you can say, every movement had to be sketched. We had to be clear as to how it is going to appear finally before we animate it. Because any changes we had to do now, because otherwise it will take us longer to execute on it. So we had to actually plan for every shot. As you can see, how the crowds will appear, how the temple will look like, where people will stand, how big or small each of this, the proportions will look like. Everything had to be planned in advance. In the next slide, I'm just showing how when the screen comes, we had to position everything. Okay. So we used to, and as you can see, everything is drawn by hand and then taken to the computer. And then it is like, this is called staging. So we had to stage and check whether the characters and the layout and all are matching. And these are some of the sketches that were done. Thousands of sketches have been done for the movie. Okay. So I just wanted to share some samples of it. The amount of work is incredible. If we were a big studio or we had the backing of a big this one, all these would have by themselves been a treasury. You know, like I still have the physical drawings of all these things sitting in a file in Trivandrum. I'm hoping to bring them all back to Bangalore at some point of time. After we had done all the sketches and things, we had to check what kind of colors will work, you know, for each scene. So whether a warm color will work, a light color will work. So all what you're seeing on the left side is actually rough coloring to say how this, what should be the mood of this, how warm should be, how light should be. because we use these inputs to doing the compositing. As you can see, how much shadow should come, how much this is. On the right is a fully composited shot. So one thing that I have done is on the website, I have created a store link. Okay, so there is a Papritika Media store link. If people go to the Punyakoti website, they can actually look at all the original. I have about 100 artworks I have uploaded. That if people want, they can buy a original high quality artwork. I'm not doing selling here, but just to say that here is how much is work has gone into making this movie and what you can do to support it. I will now pause the presentation.
Thank you very much, Ravi. I think there are a few comments which have been coming through about how beautiful the work has been. Okay. So if anybody has any questions, please do kindly ask. It's now time for us to...
Sure, Mahoday.
Yeah.
Have a few questions, Mahoday. Thank you so much, Ravishankar Mahoday. That was a very good presentation. Really loved the part two where you connected with Sanatana Dharma, the process with which you wrote the script and connected Sanatana Dharma. A few things I wanted to pick your brain. With respect to the animal dharma, right? Mm-hmm. The tiger which would not hunt, the jackal that would turn vegetarian. What was the thought process behind that? I have a few more questions I will ask and complete that. In terms of the really ending, the tiger skin being worn by, I don't know whether it is the hunter or was with a Damarukam. I don't know whether you indicated Lord Shiva there. I was not sure. I just wanted to check with you.
Yeah.
And the reason for actually collapsing the bridge, what was the thought behind that as well?
I'll try and answer the question about animal characters and the animal dharma. I, as far as concerned, I was looking for a light-hearted, no, like a sutradhara or somebody who can kind of lighten the whole atmosphere. So I was looking for an accomplice for the tiger, and the fox or the wolf looked like a natural companion for the tiger. And that was the logic of thinking about a fox or a wolf as its companion. Okay. And also the humor part where it says, I will go and join a vegetarian club, but I will not come back, because it leads a parasite kind of a life. It is living on the hunting instincts of the tiger. And when that doesn't work, it leaves the tiger. You know? So that was my thinking. Okay, and the second question about the last piece is that the song itself says that Lord Shiva was so pleased. So this is a folk song in Karnataka. And in that folk song, it is mentioned that Lord Shiva was very happy and he took the skin of the tiger.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Just that last piece about collapsing the bridge. Any particular reason?
About the collapsing of the bridge, I wanted to say that human beings think that they have accomplished a lot, you know, I mean, by actually exploiting nature, you know, big structures, big this one and everything. And for nature to restore its balance, it will just has to switch on one calamity, that's all. So it was also symbolic of the fact that man, whatever requirement he has it in his village or his domain, not encroach upon other animals' domain, other things. So the bridge was a symbolic cut to say, leave their world alone, you take care of your world. You know, so nature is saying, leave the forests alone. Don't destroy them. Leave their habitats away and you take care of your habitat. If you continue to encroach, don't think that the ocean, the forest, everything is my domain. You know, the oceans are domain of somebody else. Even before cutting a tree, you should ask permission. That is our dharma. You know, so I wanted to say that you think that development cannot be it should not be unsustainable development. So that was the symbolic aspect of the breaking of the bridge.
Dhanyavad.
And the other aspect in terms of drama itself was that the cow is on the other side of the bridge. And when the bridge breaks, how will the cow come to this shore? You know? So the tiger has gone, the is on this side of the bridge, the mother is on that side of the bridge. So I also wanted to bring this aspect that Kaveri Mata herself brings the cow to this side of the thing. So it was a little bit of dramatization.
Right. Thank you. Dhanyavad, Madhuri.
Okay. So the next, people can identify themselves first, introduce by your name and then ask the question, please. Earlier speaker was Yogi.
Yogi.
Devnathan from Singapore. So first of all, let me congratulate you for taking on such a huge project. And not many people would attempt that, you even think about it. So you've done a fantastic job at that. So congratulations to you. So you did a beautiful comparison of Satya and Dharma with integrity and workability. I mean, in real living terms, that's what it means. Rather than being abstract and saying Satya and Dharma, which says integrity and workability. So what works for people. And so that's a fantastic comparison. And the other thing I liked about was he's saying that Sanat Dharma is like open architecture. Yes, well, the technology people might understand it better, where it provides flexibility and freedom. So that's fantastic as well. So one thing I had question was, you talked about perfection. It's not being about being perfect, right? But many people, okay, one aspect of perfection is quality and excellence. You know, you excel in whatever you do, and that shows your quality of work or the final product. That's perfection there. The other aspect of perfection is truth. Many people equate perfection with truth. But you mentioned that it's not about being perfect. So can you explain that? It's about being truthful and not being just truth itself.
Okay, I said, one was that karmasu kausalam, not doing it well. Doing with whatever is given to you within that means doing it as much as possible. Not blame yourself for not being perfect, because there will never be that kind of a perfection. The only perfection, in fact, Satyam is the only perfection. In that sense, perfection as in completeness. You know, that thing left, you know, like from Purnam, if you take half also, it still remains Purnam like that. Mm. That kind of Purnam only exists in Satyam. Everything else is, because if there is no imperfection, then as they say, no problem, no life. You know, if it was perfect, this movie would never have been attempted. If this movie had been perfect, it will never give you motivation to make another movie.
Okay, the other thing I want to ask about is the practice of Sanatana Dharma in your daily life you mentioned. So I was actually thinking, many people think it's Sanatana Dharma is trying to read the scriptures and trying to follow that. But you are saying it's in your everyday life, you can follow simple things based on certain concepts that you find in our scriptures. I was thinking if you can just list a few things, and that would be useful for many of us, just how you been following Sanatana Dharma in your normal daily life.
Okay.
That would be very nice to have.
Okay. See, I can tell a lot of things, okay, which are very strict. But for me, very, very practical things that people don't, all of us take bath, all of us do japa, all of us enjoy festivals, all of us make sweets during our festivals, wear new dress, none of that. I am discounting. All this would have happened even by default. But a few aspects of Sanatana Dharma that I think are very important is not to blame anybody. Mm. That is a practice. Okay. that requires a lot of this one. For example, I have all human failings. Like I get anger, I get jealous, I get upset. Okay. But I am able to somewhere, you know, forgive myself and forgive everybody around me and come back to normalcy very, very quickly. In relation, if you say earlier, if I used to hold grudges for many years, okay, I will not speak to that person. Okay, I will not speak to this person. This person was unkind to me. This person got better rating than me in the appraisal, even though both of us did the same work. That guy got promotion. All these thoughts come to me. Okay, but one thing I've realized is that I am not shy to say that these thoughts come to me. I can openly admit that I am going through a journey. Okay. I have my own weaknesses. I am making mistakes. And it is okay. So what it helps me is to gain that connection back very quickly, rather than wallow in guilt and upset and hatred and all those things. You know, one thing is you can permanently get caught in all these things. I'm not saying I've completely come out, but at least that awareness is very, very deep inside me that all this is temporary. You know, all this is happening only to this Jivatma. But I am something more than all of these things. I have not completed all my mistakes in life. I still will make many more mistakes in my life. I will still get angry with my loved ones. Okay. I will still make a lot of financial mistakes, emotional mistakes, relationship mistakes. But I don't have any hesitation to go and ask for a sorry, ask for forgiveness, or ask. For me, that aspect of Sanatana Dharma is much more satisfying than anything else. If I am watching a very negative criticism, this one, that one, everything, at a point I am able to tell myself, okay, I am wallowing in all these things. I have to come out. There are more wonderful things to do with my time. So for me, if we can follow that, otherwise, what is the use, right? Like, otherwise we just read the scriptures, we just say, Ganga, Jalamapi, Kanika, Pita, this, that, everything, helping others is important, this is not permanent, this is not this one, Bhajagovidam is important. But I am able to, one is studying all that, second thing is practicing all that. For me, that is more important. It doesn't matter if I don't take bath one day, or if I don't do japa one day. But all that will, of course, help me. They will reinforce, they will build my willpower, they will bring in that kind of sadhana inside me. But that is my experience. That is how I am practicing it, okay? I am not...
It's a very good way to put it, Ravi Mahodaya. In fact, at this point, I can also add to the participants that this is the same effort we are also trying to convey. The practical aspect of practicing Sanatana Dharma beyond the theoretical understanding. So our workshops are typically around that, and we do a 10-day workshop on the same lines. Okay, more questions, please. I think it's always a great opportunity to have people like this who are not only successful in carrying out certain tasks that they have taken up, but also be grounded in the very essence of life, how a life should be lived. So I think, Ravi, I have one question if I can ask about the movie itself. For me, there are two things which touched me, but one interesting area which touched me more was how sorry I felt for the tiger, fair enough, but I was also feeling sorry for the wolf, because he or she was actually losing the livelihood. Remember the scene where actually the flashback, of course, the tiger lost the family because the humans have set fire to the forest, lost the family. And for a person like that to still come back at the end of the movie to forgive or let go, not forgive, but let go of its meal, shows the degree of compassion it has. So that's definitely was already captured in your explanation. But the wolf, what would you say about the wolf? Because it was a companion, and it is actually teasing its master to hunt. It's actually reminding the tiger of its duty. What do you say about it?
Yeah, I completely agree. Okay, because see here, that is why that connection, right? If the tiger hunts, then there is a parasite, or like there is somebody like a wolf that can live on the leftovers. So, which also is the psychical aspect of it. When one aspect I wanted to bring out was like, we don't live alone, right? We live off the benefit of a lot of others. Okay. And so that is one thing I wanted to bring it. And I wanted to actually close on a positive note also. That's why I showed that wolf. Actually, it now is lording over all the little birds and everything. No, it has found its niche. It's found its livelihood, its habitat. Where people generally don't frequent, it found a way of settling down in a place. And it is having a good time. It is having now followers and other things. No, it has become a fake Swamiji. So I'm just saying that, like, see, all this happens in the drama of life. It should not be, we need not be judgmental about
yeah.
it.
No? Sure. Okay, any more?
Mahadev, Yogi again, sorry. I just want yeah. to say, I envy you actually, where you had a chance to work with the great Raja sir. He's like God for me, as in with respect to music. Any more things that you want to share about Raja sir?
Oh, yeah, yeah. See, we talk about integrity, you know. I was a nobody, absolute nobody when I met him. Absolute nobody. I have not made a movie. I'm a failed filmmaker, okay? I went and told him the story. He told me, okay, if you find a producer, if you make the movie, I will give you music. Okay. He gave me this word in 2014. Okay. And I go to him in June 2019. And he is, so, sir, I have, with a lot of vairagyam, I have completed the movie. And I told it as if it was my accomplishment. He said, okay. You bring the movie. I want to see the movie. He patiently saw, without music, without this one, he saw the entire movie. In two places, a bell sound was missing. The tiger was moving its hand, but the bell was not ringing. It had the bell in its hand. He said, these two places, bell sound is not there. So that is how sharply he watches a movie. Okay. And another thing, when we showed this song to him, the children's fantasy, he composed the song, music and everything. He wrote the lyrics, and college children were coming and singing the song. Okay, so the recording, he had taught the song. Children, the girls went, they were singing. About 10 girls were there, they were all singing. So he came to supervise, okay, and he is in the console, the mixing console. After Pallavi is over, he is looking at telling them, they are singing perfectly, okay? There is no loss of Shruti, nothing, perfect. He says, will children sing like this? Children don't know about Shruti, Laya, this, that, everything, right? They just are enjoying and they will sing. Then actually one of the girls, no? She kind of said in a false voice, purato jakatatuna, she said, yeah, like that only children sing. They don't know about all these rules and everything. So you sing it from the heart. So immediately he went and stood among them. And at that moment, you should have seen, he was probably, you can probably count, he was just 10 years or 8 years like that. His body language, everything changed. Like among these girls, he was standing like a small child. You know, and he was smiling you can never capture that feeling. Okay, he's like, and he's enjoying that song so much. And he's, because of that vibes, no, that he is behaving like a child. The people who were singing also were behaving like a child. They were laughing. He said, you laugh for 5 minutes continuously. Then we will do recording. And you can, that is captured in that song. Like how
it's so nice to hear this anecdote.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. As Yogi says, even I've been an ardent fan and a devotee of Ilayaraja. And when you mentioned about the news piece I have seen in, while I was in Singapore about Punyakoti, surely one of the reasons, of course, was Sanskrit, but also the mention of Ilayaraja. And I couldn't really miss the opportunity to have my name associated in anything that has Ilayaraja on it. Okay, I would encourage others. There are only a few minutes left. Yeah, please go ahead, Anandi. We can hear again.
Nimittam is the one, first your point is very impressive. The minute we keep our attitude that we are only a nimittam, we are not taking the ownership. Like ownership is for only the karma kaushalam, not for that this is mine, that we are only a reason, you know. The nimittam is the very right approach to take it. That's the Ajji's wisdom. Even in the movie, I really, really could take it as a value to take it like that. And second thing is the hero and villain. Yeah, the tiger, actually what Malladi told me, that the tiger really makes us to feel so sorry for the tiger finally, because it is dharma to have the food, but it also, you know, like appreciated the value of the Punyakoti and it just backed out, which is, you know, beautiful, very well done. And more than that, the values you have shared today, thank you very much, Ravi.
Thank you.
Okay.
Somebody, Amulya and Uma Bala has mentioned that Adamodi Galate is very apt for that particular thing. In fact, that there are a couple of anecdotes I will share. Adamodi Galate was not planned. The person said, the conductor said, after watching this scene, whatever comes to your mind, you play. And all of them in unison said, Adamodi Galata to suit this. See, they have not seen the movie. They have not done anything. Okay. And same scene, actually, there is a shlokam which comes. There is a sutram that gets played. So, I am saying how nature and destiny works in your favor. We were not planning to put that, actually. So that is actually Vrishti Suktam. Vrishti Suktam is for bringing rains. I accidentally met a person on the way in a bus coming from Sringeri. And this person is a young person. He has gotten an award for following, being a Veda Pandita and everything. He's a 27-year-old boy, actually. He didn't get a bus to go back to Tamil Nadu. So I told him, why are you waiting? He said, I don't know anybody in Bangalore, I'm waiting. I said, come home, you have love. So since you don't know anybody in Bangalore, so I took him. So he asked me, what are you doing? I said, I'm making this movie. Oh, is it? So I showed him. He said, and I had just put some mantra kind of a sound there. He said, Anna, why have you put this? There is something called Vrishti Suktam, which is for bringing rains. I will go back to my Veda Parashala. I will get all the children. They will all together chant Vrishti Suktam for you. So he sent me the entire Vrishti Suktam. I just forwarded it to my sound recordist in Bombay. He cut and put it in that place. See, it was as if everybody was working on my movie instead of me.
So nice to hear that. I think the energy, one thing I must say is, Ravi, since the project has started, it has been an uphill task. There is no doubt about it. And I don't think anybody else could have actually been able to bear the turmoil that you have managed to face. Bear, I must say. You faced and you were able to bear it. And surely, I think, as you rightly said, the essence of Sanatana Dharma is something which must have made it easier for you. Would you agree?
Completely agree.
Yeah. Fantastic. I think this is a practical life scenario, life story, a life study. It's a practical life study of how to live Sanatana Dharma. And I'm so pleased that Ravi has joined us today in not only sharing about his successful movie, but also about how well he applies Sanatana Dharma in his life. I think we should all be unapologetic in how we understand. First of all, I think we need to raise our awareness of what Sanatana Dharma is, and also be unapologetic about practicing it. It's not that we have to show it. It's not about wearing it on the sleeve, as somebody says, but it should be in the heart.
Mm-hmm.
So,
in our benefit, Sanatana Dharma will not lose anything.
Yes, no, that's true, absolutely. Yeah. Yes.
Sanatana Dharma will stay.
Okay. Yeah.
Even
yeah.
if what, no 0% follow it, Sanatana Dharma will stay. It is in our benefit that we have to follow it.
Yeah, that's right. I think we'll end with a couple of comments made in the chat, which are quite nice. I think you should hear as well. What a wonderful venture. This is from Rahi. May you and your team be blessed to bring Sanatana Dharma alive. This is so needed to awaken us to the truth, beauty, and wisdom embedded in this extraordinary culture. Many blessings. Looking forward to your future further offerings. So I think all power to you, Ravi. Perhaps you should be coming back strongly with one more project at least. And let us hope this one will be easier. And I think as you previously told me once, now the hard work has been done. I'm sure you know all the tricks by now.
Yeah. I know 100 ways of not making a Sanskrit movie.
Well, I didn't hear that. Okay, enjoyed the movie and I discover new things each time I watch it. Thank you so much, says Sindhu. Priyamvada, thank you very much for a wonderful session. And Maitri also says a lot of strength to you. Samhita, I think I speak to all my fellow teens and kids when I say Punyakoti did an amazing job. I think she's basically saying she's happy to share.
Thank you, Mahodaya.
Oh, Anuchandran Bhagini, yes. You want to say something? Yes.
Yes. His anecdote on the Vrishti Suktam really got me goosebumps. it was as though the whole was conspiring to, make this happen. Yeah. And all the anecdotes that he said, whether it was of Maestro Ilayaraja or of this Veda Pandita who just happened to be there in the bus stand and who offered his help in the form of Vrishti Suktam, it was so wonderful. And the best part of the whole presentation was his humility in saying that I was just the nimittam in spite of going through such an uphill task as you came. And congratulations and may God bless you.
So lots of comments coming through, but importantly, I think these are all wishes for you to stay strong and come back stronger with one more project.